Have you got a lawyer in the...
Oh, yes.
And if some of us, yes, if we accidentally libeled someone, they'd stop.
And then providing it's one of us, he cuts it out. If it's a clergyman, they just leave it in.
Good evening, welcome to Have I Got News For You? I'm David Mitchell. In the news this week, at the Athletics Championships in Madrid, competitors have developed a new ploy to avoid being tested for drugs after winning their events. At Frogmore House, there are rumours that Harry and Meghan might not be getting their deposit back. And at his home in Islington, it appears that even Keir Starmer's dog has lost respect for him. On Ian's team tonight is the writer, broadcaster and Church of England vicar who was voted out second when he took part in Strictly Come Dancing because, like God, he moved in a mysterious way. Please welcome the Reverend Richard Cole. And with Paul tonight is a Scottish comedian who ran a pub in Glasgow for 14 years. So don't worry, she's used to dealing with prominent local hard nuts like Ian and Richard. Please welcome Janey Godley. We begin with the bigger news stories of the week. Paul and Janey, have a look at this. Mm.
Boris Johnson in a plane, Dominic Cummings, here he is imitating the Beverly Sisters. Empty shopping trolley. He said Boris was like an empty shopping trolley. There's Matt Hancock getting ready to be tested for something. or other. So, yes, Dominic Cummings has given evidence, 7 hours worth, I believe, made lots of powerful statements, and somebody's lying somewhere in the middle of all this. There's not everybody's telling the truth. So he's made various accusations, and Boris and Matt Hancock have denied them.
And it's good that we've got David on tonight.
Yes.
Because it's an episode of Would I Lie to You?
Yes. Yes.
And the answer is from everyone, yes, they did.
Yeah. So, Ian, who do you believe in the middle of all this?
When Cummings is talking about other people getting everything wrong, I believe him. When he's talking about himself being innocent, he's lying. I mean, it's right there from the beginning. He said Boris Johnson is not fit to be Prime Minister. Of course he isn't. He appointed you. It doesn't take 8 hours, does it?
Yes, these are the revelations of Dominic Cummings at the Commons Select Committee, including that Boris Johnson is not fit to be Prime Minister. It's not the bombshell he hoped. what was Cummings' message essentially?
His claim is that he is now revealing the truth about what really was going on at number 10 in the years of pandemic. But he's someone who has made a career on not being able to distinguish between truth and fiction. He's someone who thinks integrity is the new kind of Land Rover. And it's not a surprise, is it, that he's not entirely a credible witness.
He didn't go to Barnard Castle because he was worried about the virus. Apparently he had a hitman on his tail. So he put his kid in the car and drove with bad eyesight, which was like the opening scenes of Casualty.
And when he says, last time I appeared before the public, obviously I wasn't telling the truth, but this time I am. And all you can think of is, what about next time, Dominic?
Yes, that was a key thing, that he said he was lying when he said he was going there for childcare reasons, but the real reason was that there'd been death threats. Well, the thing about the someone was trying to kill me excuse is that when it comes to him, it's extremely believable.
And he did that classic thing at the start of saying, it's all everybody else's fault. Would you believe it? The government has really handled this very badly. If only there'd been someone at the heart of government who could have said this whole thing's going wrong. Maybe an advisor, maybe...
A senior advisor.
A senior advisor.
Yeah.
I mean, he literally is, you know, an arsonist pretending to be a firefighter. It was one of the most disgusting performances in public life that I can remember.
When you say he's an arsonist, is that word not slightly too long?
I had a sort of vicarish moment when he began and he said that he wanted to acknowledge his shortcomings, quite a phrase. And a little bit of me thought, oh, that's really good. And then I realised, actually, his sort of full confession was merely weaponising his evidence so it could be used against other people. The whole thing... I mean, it's extraordinary, isn't it? A global pandemic is used as a pretext for a bitch fight like Alexis and Crystal in the Lily Pond on Dynasty. For viewers under 50, it's like Hollyoaks, but with a bigger budget.
and very un-COVID safe.
Very un-COVID safe. Yeah.
Well, he did, to be fair, he had the decency to say...
To be fair, what is wrong with you?
To be fair, the whole of Scotland was watching it going, keep going. Dig a bigger hole, Dominic. Give Dominic a shovel. Get tore in, fella. Because the whole of Scotland's like, this is reason we don't want anything to do with these people.
Cummings did have the decency to say this about himself.
It is completely crazy that I should have been in such a senior position.
I mean, it's hard to think he's lying then.
No.
Assuming we can believe a word the devious bastard says, who is to blame for everything?
Well, the Prime Minister is to blame for everything. Mm. And the Prime Minister should never have become Prime Minister, except this is the man who almost single-handedly worked to make him Prime Minister. And it's also absolutely extraordinary that he only noticed that the Prime Minister was utterly useless when he was sacked. It just didn't occur to him the whole time he was on board with the project.
Still,
and then suddenly, oh, my goodness, I've suddenly realised. You're an idiot, and so am I.
I think it's aimed at the Health Secretary in particular, who he doesn't seem to have a great deal of love and respect for.
Here's what he said about Matt Hancock.
I think that the Secretary of State for Health should have been fired for at least 15, 20 things, including lying to everybody in multiple occasions, in meeting after meeting, in the Cabinet room and publicly.
Rosie?
Oh, dear.
it's nice when a politician has the honesty to show when they're pleased.
He specifically goes for the Health Secretary, but he doesn't mention Michael Gove at all.
Yeah.
Once. I mean, Michael Gove was in charge of as much as anyone else during the early pandemic, and he's been let off completely. It's a select committee, and the evidence is very selective. I mean, it's the most pathetic score-settling by a man, and if you go through his evidence, it just doesn't stand up. The only things that stand up are the things that we all knew anyway. All of us, even the, you know, filthy journalist and press endlessly trying to make trouble, we put all these allegations to Number 10. Number 10, oh, who's the spokesman? Dominic Cummings. He denied them all at the time. Mm. Now, oh, I've just noticed. It's... anyway. It's beyond belief.
Yeah. Yes, the 15 to 20 things included blaming NHS staff for not using PPE correctly. Apparently, yep. Hancock did that. Lying about the nation's state of preparedness. Obviously, Cummings also did that. Trying to hold the daily tests back in order to guarantee hitting his 100,000 tests a day target on a particular day. And the key thing, having old people sent back from hospitals to care homes without being tested for COVID. According to Cummings, Hancock said people going into care homes would be tested, but they weren't. However, on the official Department of Health website, government guidelines said negative tests are not required prior to transfers admissions into the care home. That's from the beginning of April 2020. So that was government policy. That wasn't Matt Hancock lying to the Prime Minister that they were being tested.
No, and all those things are true. I mean, they are responsible for tens of thousands of deaths, but Cummings can't just turn up and say, everyone else has been saying this for a year, I now believe it to be true, aren't I great? No.
Do we know what sort of mood Matt Hancock was in on the morning of the revelations?
Ebullient.
He was running about.
Yeah.
Well, let's have a look.
Are you worried about Dominic Cummings giving evidence today, Mr. Hancock?
Nat West has asked him not to wear that 50M. What was Hancock's reaction at the end of the day of Cummings' brutal takedown of him?
He said he hadn't watched, didn't he?
He did. Let's take a look.
Well, I haven't seen this performance today in full, and instead I've been dealing with getting the vaccination rollout going, especially to over 30s, and saving lives.
He really is Alan Partridge, isn't he? He really is.
Well, Cummings claims that the government was unfocused and chaotic in the first few weeks of the pandemic, and there are a number of reasons for this. Shall we play a game with the randomizer of confusion?
Yes,
oh, yes, please.
OK, identify the picture and give me a reason. Fingers on buzzers. Here's the first one.
It's a pig. Next question.
Yes. It is a pig.
Yeah.
It's another pet for Carrie.
Oh, that would be very her, wouldn't it, I think? Well, I mean, she likes Boris, doesn't she? No, the pig is a reference to how Boris Johnson thought the coronavirus was no more dangerous than swine flu.
Oh, yes.
Oh, and he said that he would like Professor Whitty to inject him with the virus live on television.
Yes.
So he could prove that it was nothing and he was immortal.
Yeah, it's not too late to do that, is it?
Next.
Is that the story about Carrie upset that somebody didn't like the look of your dog on Instagram or something? I don't even know what the story is, but she was upset that somebody didn't like her dog.
Yes, I don't know what the story is either, because it was overshadowed by the coronavirus pandemic.
By people dying. Yeah. There was people dying, but still, somebody said something nasty about her dog.
You're pronouncing dog as Doug, is that it?
Doug. It's Scotland for dog.
Is it? So, what do you call people who are called Doug?
Doug.
Doug.
Doug has got a dog.
If the dog dies and you have to dig a hole, have you dug a hole for Doug? Have you dug a hole for Doug? Is it ding a dong a ding dong, Doug?
Yes, this is Dylan. This is the bloody dog.
Yeah.
Who caused confusion in Downing Street because, according to Cummings, the Prime Minister's girlfriend was going completely crackers about Number 10 handling press inquiries about the couple's dog's misbehaviour. Next.
Was it?
Mm-hmm.
Donald Trump was gazumping other countries for the PPE and at the same time threatening to bomb some country because he woke up with indigestion. Was it that?
It was the bombing, yeah. Horror of horrors, Donald Trump was on the phone. He was at the time President of the United States, as some of you may remember. according to Cummings, on March the 12th, national security people came in saying Trump was calling Downing Street wanting us to join a bombing campaign in the Middle East. Sounds like, oh, come on, let's all go bombing. Like, let's all go out for a pizza. Fortunately, we didn't join in, and now peace reigns throughout the region. And finally.
Well, Boris Johnson apparently is writing a biography of Shakespeare, which very little is known about. And so how he's going to do it, I don't know. He's going to probably just read other people's books and pretend he wrote it himself.
Yes.
But again, Dominic Cummings yesterday, you did get the sense that it was more like kind of King Lear, wasn't it? Some terrible court.
It's more Macbeth, though, isn't it? It's the rise to the top, steeped in blood.
Yeah. Surely after the last by-elections, it's Love, Labour's lost. Surely.
But, yes, this is Shakespeare, whose biography, according to Cummings, was being written by Boris Johnson in January and February 2020, causing him to miss several important Cobra meetings on the virus. According to the Daily Star, a spokesman for the Prime Minister said, I am not aware of Mr Johnson doing any... Oh. Sorry. On the book. This is Dominic Cummings's appearance before two parliamentary select committees. Cummings said that at the beginning of the crisis, it was like a scene from Independence Day. The aliens were here. Till someone whispered, no, I think that's Chris Whitty. Criticising the health secretary, Dominic Cummings claimed, Matt Hancock should have been fired for at least 15 to 20 reasons. although Hancock has pledged to get that number up to 100,000. Ian and Richard, take a look at this.
This is Ryanair's flight to Minsk. And Mr. Lukashenko, the president for life and beyond of that town with his friend Putin. The nearest to North Korea Europe gets, apparently, Belarus.
Yes, this is the news that a Ryanair flight was diverted and forced to land in Belarus so a journalist critical of President Lukashenko could be arrested.
His name's Roman Potasevich, just in case anything happens to him. Nice to remember him.
Passengers suspected that something was wrong when the plane started to descend into Minsk, a very long way from its advertised destination of Vilnius, even for Ryanair. how exactly did the state hijacking take place?
They said there was an allegation of a bomb on board, and they sent up a MiG to escort the plane to its unintended destination of Minsk, and it just happened to have on board one of the most resolute critics of President Lukashenko in the person of Roman Protasevich, who was deplaned with his girlfriend, Sofia Spopega. Ryanair invented priority deboarding for that particular...
Yes. A colleague of the journalist suspected Russian involvement, tweeting, "When the plane entered Belarus airspace, KGB agents initiated a fight with the Ryanair crew." I wonder who came out best out of that. And why was Lukashenko so keen to get his hands on 26-year-old Roman Protasevich?
Well, he'd written a blog which was critical of the dictator and said he'd rigged the last elections and that dissent was a reasonable idea and he'd had to go into exile. But that's no good anymore. There is no exile. You know, it's like living in Salisbury or being in Hong Kong. I mean, these people will just come and get you at some point.
Yes. on which note, I'd like to say I think they're great. yes, what do we know about President Lukashenko?
We know that he's not very good with criticism. He's a little bit testy, a little bit touchy. We know that he weaponized Belarus's entry into the Eurovision Song Contest in order to denounce his critics. He also has a fondness for big hats that make him look like Shuey McPhee in Crossroads. and he lacks appeal.
Yeah, and he once said of his country, before he came to power, "Belarus stood at the edge of an abyss and I helped it take a step forward."
Wow.
As well as Protasevich and his girlfriend, another man got off the plane in Minsk. Why?
He was closer to where he wanted to go.
Yes, he was...
He thought he got the Ryanair flight to Frankfurt.
he was a Greek national who was actually heading to Minsk anyway to see his wife. So, you know, every cloud. and apparently it's a great anecdote for him. And, funny thing was, I thought I was going to have to change. But no, I was really early, and then I got home and she was having an affair. Let's move on from one courageous, principled young journalist to a journalist that's a deceitful shit. What's the latest on the Martin Bashir scandal?
Well, Mr. Bashir has failed to uphold the highest standards of BBC journalism by faking bank statements. And I think Tony Hall, who was then the head of news, later director general, decided that there was no case to answer. And by coincidence, he stepped down as chair of trustees at the National Gallery last week.
Yes, in the wake of the Dyson report describing Tony Hall's investigation into the Panorama interview with Diana as woefully ineffective, the former BBC director general has resigned from his position as chairman of the National Gallery. He left the building under the disapproving glare of a number of people. What had Lord Hall concluded at the end of his piss-poor investigation into whether Bashir used forged documents to...
Well, that Martin Diana. Bashir was so honest that, in fact, he made him BBC religion editor in 2016 to the surprise of everyone throughout the corporation and, indeed, Christendom.
Yes, despite Bashir repeatedly lying about showing the forged documents to Earl Spencer, Hall concluded that Bashir had just had a lapse and was an honest and honourable man. It's been suggested that when Bashir was rehired in 2016, he simply had to attend a cappuccino interview, although this has been denied. Maybe it was a latte. have you ever heard of a cappuccino interview?
They're monks, aren't they?
So you're interviewed by monks.
Interviewed by a monk to get a job at the BBC in the religious department. That makes perfect sense. They recorded that hit song, "I Left My Heart with Some Franciscans."
Well, a BBC spokesman has denied this about the interview, saying we can confirm there was an interview process for this position. Traditionally, interviews at the BBC involve a three-person board, so the spokesman is confirming that there were indeed three of them in that interview. I managed to fluff that quite nice joke.
No, do it again.
Traditionally, interviews involve a three-person BBC board, so the spokesman is confirming that there were indeed three of them in that interview.
That was very consistent. It went exactly the same way the second time as it did the first.
did I screw it up in exactly the same way?
You delivered it perfectly.
Yeah.
I don't think you screwed it up the first time. Nobody laughed.
They knew what it was going to be.
They knew.
They had the information. It just arrived in the wrong comic format.
Exactly.
Yeah. Audiences are so unforgiving about that.
Yeah.
We're in a pandemic.
I tell you what. Without any warning, leave it later, do it a third time, without any warning, you'll get a laugh for the sheer nerve of doing it a third time. But don't telegraph it, just do it.
OK.
That's my advice.
It'll come at any time.
Yeah, any time.
Good. Just surprise us.
Yeah. I love when a man tells me it's going to happen.
although Martin Bashir has resigned, what is the BBC still doing?
Paying him,
yes.
Correct.
They're all getting their pensions, aren't they? Mm. All of the people that the report said were guilty.
The thing is that makes me so angry about it is the thing that makes people love the BBC is not the ruddy news. The news is a boring programme. We all know it. And in their desperate attempts to make the news watchable, they've stooped to tabloid tactics, and that is going to destroy a corporation that is loved for the drama and comedy and documentaries it's produced for decades. And the Tories will cheerfully get rid of that and use this bullshit as an excuse. And Martin Bashir may have unwittingly been the executioner of the BBC. Makes me very angry and bitter. But it had to come. Nevertheless, the BBC is still paying him because he was allowed to resign rather than being sacked for some reason. So he'll be on the payroll until August. You couldn't make it up. Well, he could, but he didn't on this occasion. Who else is now hoping their concerns about Martin Bashir's conduct will be taken up?
Mike. Oh, no, he's dead. I was going to say Michael Jackson.
Not Michael Jackson, no. It's Terry Venables. He claims to have been stitched up by Bashir in an interview, as does George Best's widow, Alex, while the mother of murdered girl Karen Hadaway claims she gave items of her daughter's clothing to Bashir to be DNA tested for a BBC documentary he was making and that they were never returned. When asked about this by The Times, Bashir said, "I may have lost it, but I don't remember." Still on the payroll.
God.
This is the Ryanair plane that was diverted to Belarus, leading to the arrest of dissident Roman Protasevich. Belarus was sadly banned from entering last weekend's Eurovision, but luckily, Amanda Holden was on hand to restore our national pride after our entry scored a grand total of 0 points. Let's have a look.
Amanda Holden!
My goodness.
Good evening, bonsoir. Goedenavond. That is good evening in French and Dutch, although I've got absolutely no idea which is which.
And you wonder why we get null points. Good evening. Do you hate us? Please, vote now.
The thing I find inexplicable about that is I can't believe she doesn't know that bonsoir is French. I mean, she will have been to France. She will have done French at school. It's very basic French. Mm. By a process of elimination, she knows which one is Dutch.
Yeah. But we've just had hours and hours of everybody else perfectly speaking English as a sort of politeness towards us. On she comes and says, "Blimey, foreign, eh?"
Yeah.
And that's our contribution to Eurovision.
Our entry by James Newman scored literally nothing, something which, according to the organisers, with the scoring system implemented in 2016, should have been technically impossible. So well done us. Meanwhile, the BBC's under fire for its failed investigation into Martin Bashir and his later return as religion editor. According to The Times, Bashir was rehired to win the BBC more awards. And it's worked. They've just won the BAFTA for worst cover-up. Despite all the scandals and disgrace, Martin Bashir still has a very impressive CV. He would do. He's forged it. So, at the end of that round, it's 2 points each. Mm. And so to round two, the strengthometer of news.
Hooray.
Fingers on buzzers, teams. Here's the first one.
Is it something to do with trying to find a code for happiness?
Yes, because the first symbol you can see on the blackboard is clearly chocolate.
This is the news that scientists have found the secret to happiness. Let's have a look at it.
Yeah.
There's happiness.
Yeah, yeah, I recognise it now.
Do you know, any of you, what that equation means in layman's terms?
No, of course you don't.
I thought it was a Friends reunion in as a sort of chemical diagram.
I've seen a bit of the Friends reunion, and I'd say reading that equation is more entertaining. it means in layman's terms,
yes,
lower your expectations.
Yeah.
Oh.
But, I mean, how do you lower your expectations, Richard?
You get ordained in the Church of England. That's a very low bar indeed.
How did neuroscientists at University College London work
with having an awful lot of time in their hands during a pandemic?
Yes, basically, they used MRI scans of people's brains and a gaming app which showed that, according to Professor Rob Rutledge, happiness depended not on how well they were doing, but whether they were doing better than expected.
But my mammy could have gave you that advice 150 years ago. All those Glasgow grannies, just marry somebody who looks like they'll stay alive, can carry a bag of coal and not make you pregnant too many times.
Yeah. I think that's
the
same thing, yeah. Well, the example they gave was slightly different.
Yeah.
There are times, such as on holiday, when lowering your expectations might not be a bad idea. Just coincidentally, that's the new slogan of Visit England. This is a new study from UCL, which has devised a formula for the secret to happiness. The study went on to conclude, you may enjoy yourself more if you don't expect everything to go perfectly. In that case, Matt Hancock must be like a pig in shit. The main conclusion is that people should lower their expectations. One researcher explained, if you make plans to meet a friend after work, you may be unhappy if they suddenly cancel. Unhappy? I'd be ecstatic. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Here's the next one.
Now, there's a lovely story going round that Boris, desperate to make ends meet and burning the midnight oil writing his Life of Shakespeare, doesn't have time to do a stir fry, Carrie's too busy with the dog. So he's been getting deliveries of luxury hampers from Daylesford Organic, which is a very posh shop round the corner, and there's an allegation that they've been paid for by Lady Bamford, who is a significant Tory donor. I think her family gave the Tory party 10 million quid. And perhaps with that...
What are you suggesting?
Well, I'm not suggesting anything at all, but it
is good, I can.
Yes, that is absolutely right. These are covert deliveries of Daylesford food that the Daily Mail has revealed Boris Johnson's been receiving. He was given a code name, Alex, and the deliveries were placed in plain white paper bags for discretion, which were then delivered by Boris Spike to number 10 by the owner of Daylesford, Lady Bamford's personal butler. We've got a picture here.
Is that Dominic Cummings on the bike? Looks like he's got a new job.
Yeah.
It's the JCB lot, aren't they, the Bamfords?
Are they?
Yes, I think they built...
Are you suggesting something else now, that there's some form of investment in his company?
I wouldn't dream of suggesting such a thing. I just want Britain to be great.
I think I'm going to manage my expectations. I want Britain to decline slowly. The cost of the food was £27,000, as you say. Before you ask whether Boris and Carrie paid for the luxury organic food themselves, as you say, the cost has been met. According to the Daily Mail, the leaked documents show some of the items as charged to LB's account, believed to stand for Lady Bamford, whose husband has donated several million pounds to the Conservative Party, or in Daylesford organic terms, three Scotch eggs. meanwhile, what thrilling news did we learn about Ed Miliband this week?
He's still alive.
He has revealed in a new book, which I must get, that he only mastered the art of riding a bike at the age of 50. Before then, he had been too scared to ride on two wheels. Ed wrote, I left it more than three decades before doing anything more than a few minutes of uncomfortable wobbling. A very self-deprecating way to refer to his performance at the dispatch box. What did Ed briefly consider using as a mode of transport instead of a bicycle?
A tricycle?
Yes. Yes, he claims he once had a brief flirtation with an adult tricycle.
Yes.
But the idea was ditched because Ed was worried about the paparazzi taking pictures and making him look stupid. Yeah. Imagine. And finally, in this bit, what have Priti Patel and Boris Johnson both been wearing recently?
Hard hats.
They're always wearing hard hats.
Yeah, viz jackets.
Yeah. It's that sort of territory.
Label jackets. Jackets telling you their job on it.
That's exactly it, and it's unbearable.
In case somebody forgets who they are.
Yeah. Here's Priti on an immigration raid in London.
Oh, dear.
She's got that face that looks like your auntie when she's been told she's not getting a free tote bag off the Avon lady.
Here's Boris in Portsmouth.
Jesus wept.
Probably can't get a jacket with twat written on it, can you? Probably can't get one.
This is the news that the wife of a Tory donor may have been paying for some of Boris's takeaway meals. Also this week, in a moving interview, Sir Keir Starmer revealed that his father was a toolmaker. Well, that's certainly what Angela Rayner thinks. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Yes.
Well, now, there's a story, I can't remember where it was, probably The Telegraph, that there is certain crafts are threatened with extinction, among them compass making, kilt weaving and glass eye making.
I've got all three in the house.
You're keeping the industries alive. Well done, yeah. Janey.
You're right. This is the news that the Heritage Crafts Association has recently added 20 crafts to its red list of endangered skills, whereas some crafts have seen an upturn during the pandemic and have moved up to the currently viable list. Sadly, some are already extinct. So, shall we play a game of endangered, viable, extinct?
Well, yeah. Yes, but before we do, can yeah. I just suggest the reason why the glass eyeball industry might be going through a bad phase is they're making their eyes far too big.
So, first up,
yeah,
rug tufting. Endangered, viable or extinct?
Endangered.
It's not endangered, it's viable.
Is it?
Yeah. Anyone know what it is?
It's making Trump's hair.
It's pulling yarn through a canvas to create a rug. Next, vegetable tanning.
Totally illegal. Shouldn't be allowed.
It's endangered.
Certainly is endangered.
It is endangered.
Totally.
Do you know what it is?
Yeah, it's preparation for a new series of The Only Way is Essex.
Yeah.
I do know what this is.
Absolutely.
Vegetable tanning in Scotland means eating a lot of vegetables. It does. You got to tan that? Yeah, I'm tanning all my vegetables.
That really is a dying art, isn't it? Vegetables yeah. in Scotland.
No. Don't, Richard. Don't go there.
Sorry.
Next, withy pot making.
Endangered.
Critically endangered, yes.
Yes.
Do you know what it is?
No.
It's making crab or lobster pots from willow.
Let the crabs and lobsters make their own pots. No, we make pots for crabs and lobsters.
They refuse to want to get trapped.
Really?
It's very selfish of them. It's almost like they've never tasted themselves.
Yeah.
You sort of go, I know, if you knew what you were like with mayonnaise, you'd commit suicide.
Exactly.
Next, glass eye making.
Definitely down a downturn.
Critically endangered.
Absolutely.
And obviously teaching it is difficult because there aren't enough pupils.
Oh.
Thank you.
Now would be a yes. good time to do that Martin Bashir joke again.
And
because you've already lowered their expectations. Yeah,
yeah. Yes. You're gonna be so happy so soon. Knitting is one that's on the safe list, though. Why has one woman, however, returned this perfectly lovely knitted jumper to a charity shop this week?
I would guess by the way the photo is framed that there is no hole in the bottom of the sleeves, that they're sealed up.
No.
No?
The offended shopper wanted a refund as she saw Gail Platt wearing it on corridor. This is the news that 20 traditional crafts have now been classified as endangered by the Heritage Crafts Association. One of them is glass eye making, which is deemed critically endangered. And for those of you who enjoyed the BBC's Great British Glass Eyeball Blow-Off, make sure you tuned in for tonight's Celebrity Glass Eyeball Blow-Off to see if Paul Merton can finally manage to get the glaze to stick to his retina. In In good news, some traditional crafts are making a comeback thanks to the lockdown. According to the Heritage Crafts Association, gilding, which involves applying a layer of gold to an object, has made a comeback this year. Well, what Carrie wants, Carrie gets. Fingers on buzzers, teams.
This is in Australia. It's a plague of mice sent by God for Vegemite. It's a plague of mice that has afflicted Australia for some reason. It's been going on for a while now. But there were pictures, didn't you see, piles and piles of dead mice that have lying by the roadside as if some terrible Kylie Pied Piper of Melbourne.
This is the news that millions of mice are running amok in Australia. But it's summed up in a headline from The Sun. Danger mice, Australia mouse plague, rodent army marches on Sydney and gnaws people in their beds with outbreak stretching 1,000 kilometres. And I believe the Reverend Richard Cole has blamed God. Pest hunter Dieter Mafra told the Daily Telegraph, mice are likely hitching rides from the country into cities on food trucks. I think that's the plot of Ratatouille. And how have Australians tried to combat the problem?
Getting cats?
It's just, no, hats. No hats, no.
No cats, not hats.
Not, oh, no, I don't think they've tried cats or hats.
No.
I mean, this is incredibly unresourceful of them, the more you think about it.
Yes.
According to Xavier Martin, a grain farmer in New South Wales, people are putting the legs of their beds in buckets of water, but the mice are still climbing curtains and jumping into their beds. Richard, you've had an infestation of rodents in your rectory, I believe.
We did. We had mice get in. We got the lady who makes pork pies in Norfolk to come and pick the mice up because we were too scared. Thank you, Sarah.
Why the lady who makes pork pies in Norfolk? Is that what she puts in her pork pie?
No, not at all. Her pork pies are magnificent. No, it's just that she has a sort of brisk countrywoman's attitude towards wildlife in the wrong places. I got something creepy about it.
Well, let's move on from mice to cheese.
Yes.
How did some Stilton cheese lead to the arrest of a burglar?
He burgled the house, then sort of felt a bit peckish, so he opened the fridge and saw there was some blue cheese and started eating the cheese until the householder came down and found him.
No.
No.
But that... plausible.
Perhaps that's something that happened to me.
Yeah. Now, here's a clue. The burglar was identified from this photograph. He posted it online.
Well, how can you identify him from that?
Well, Carl Stewart, was a drug dealer in Liverpool who also had a love of Stilton, posted this picture of him holding some mature blue Stilton, and police were able to analyse his fingerprints.
Oh.
Oh.
Yeah. He will have to find more discreet ways to display his cheese online. This is the news that a plague of mice is spreading across Australia. Here's a satisfying picture of 500 dead mice. And the really good news is mouse meat is part of Liz Truss's exciting new trade deal. According to the Mail, to destroy the mice plague effectively, scientists recommend the use of super deadly rodent poison bromodialone kits. Even though the sound of it is something quite strange. Which means at the end of this round, Ian and Richard have 5 points, and Paul and Janey have 3.
Mm. Brilliant. You know everyone.
Time now for the Missing Words round, which this week features as its guest publication, the Police History Society newsletter. It has 3 editors, if they're watching. Good evening. And we start with, Andrew was surprised at the lack of information available about what?
Young female masseurs.
I'll give you a clue, it's not Prince Andrew. Oh, it's a shame when it's not Prince Andrew, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a shame.
That's what the prosecutors always say.
The answer is, Andrew was surprised at the lack of information available about rubber truncheons.
So it's still Prince Andrew.
Here's the rubber truncheon he's interested in.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
He can't even work out where the batteries go. Next, monks stole Henry VI's missing arm bone and used it as...
selfie stick.
I question this because if it's missing, how can they steal it?
This monk stole Henry VI's missing arm bone and used it as a straw to drink wine.
Ooh.
So basically, they drink wine through an arm bone in a bid to get legless. Next, ex-police officer Bill appeared on 2 episodes of What and was what in one of them?
Well, I guess because he's called ex-police officer Bill, it must be appeared on two episodes of The Bill and was killed in one of them.
No, that would actually be better than this.
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, OK.
The ex-police officer Bill appeared on two episodes of Crossroads and was a chef in one of them.
That is also better than this.
Yeah, yeah, OK.
But no, the mundane truth is ex-police officer Bill appeared on two episodes of Crime Watch and was identified as a suspect.
Wow!
Yeah. This is from Police History magazine concerning a review of a book about the near 50-year career of a British transport police officer. The reviewer wrote, "Why not purchase the book to relive Bill's tales? Price £14.95. I think you've answered your own question. Next. Photograph of what in 1972 turned out to be what?
Photograph of the moon in 1972 turned out to be a bowl of porridge in Rotherham.
I'm going to give you the first half. Photograph of Jane Fonda with police at Heathrow.
Turned out to be Danny LaRue.
Turned out to be forged by Martin Bashir.
Yes.
Yes.
Now, it is photograph of Jane Fonda with police at Heathrow in 1972 turned out to be not of police after all. Next. Woman bought what for bargain price online but turned out to be what?
Is it the woman who bought a PCR test and it turned out to be an injection of cholera?
No.
No, I've just made that up.
No, it's woman bought patio furniture for bargain price online, but turned out to be doll's house furniture.
Oh, yeah.
Here she is with the furniture.
That is a masterpiece.
It's a lovely photograph. It captures her disappointment. According to The Sun, the woman is a customer services manager, former financial advisor, and a judo back belt. That's lockdown for you. Next. MOD pays millions for tanks that what while moving?
Masturbate you.
MOD pays millions for tanks that fall to bits while moving, that shudder violently. Yep.
They make a noise.
Very close.
And the enemy can hear you. Yeah,
it's MOD pays millions for tanks that vibrate too much to shoot.
Yeah, well,
right.
Shudder
violently. I think you, yeah. According to technical experts, you can't fire the guns while the tank's being driven. Quite right, you shouldn't even use your mobile while driving. And finally, chaos in Aldi after what jumps out of what?
Chaos in Aldi after a kangaroo jumps out of a pair of leggings.
No, it's chaos in Aldi after mouse jumps out of woman's handbag.
Oh.
The woman, Stephanie Cooper, told the Metro, "I opened my zip and it jumped out." I think John Barrowman is using the same excuse. So, the final scores are Ian and Richard have 5 points and Paul and Janey have 6.
No. Oh. Unbelievable.
On which note, we say thank you to our panellists, Ian Hislop and the Reverend Richard Coles, Paul Merton and Janey Godley. And I leave you with news that, on a visit to the Lotus Factory, technicians ensure the Prime Minister is in the best place to appreciate the full effect of the high-speed test track. In a workshop in Ealing, the finishing touches are applied to the new trophy for the inaugural Martin Bashir Award for Journalism. And at the Oval, Surrey's new spin bowler baffles the opposition batsman with his googlies. Good night.